ta'ala, for all the favors and bounties Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to us. And we send salat and salam on his last and final messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In our session last week, we ended off with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's second trip to Syria. And this is when he was at the age of 25 years old. And Khadija radiallahu anha, she had hired him to take her goods to Syria. And she sent him Maisara, which is one of her slaves, to accompany him. Now we dealt with the incident that took place with Maisara. After our last session, I was asked the question if that incident is authentic. Because there are some scholars who have the opinion that this is a rejected incident and they do not accept the incident with Maisara. But when we look about the incident that took place with Maisara, it is mentioned in nearly all the books of Sirah. That is, it is mentioned in the Ibn Ishaq, which is the first book that was written about Sirah. It is mentioned as well as in the Sirah of Al-Baqiri. It is in the Sirah of Ibn Hisham. Also in the Sirah of Sirat al-Mustafa. It is in the Sirah of Tabaqat al-Sa'd in Volume 1. It is also in the book of Sa'is al-Kubra, Volume 1, as well as Uyun al-Bahar, Volume 1. So these are just some of the books that mention this incident. Now, if it was only one book that has the incident, we would understand and say, yes, there could be some type of fabrication that deals with it. That how come that all the other scholars of Sirah did not have it in their books and only one scholar had it in his book. But when you have the same incident being narrated in many, many different books of Sirah, it brings some type of authenticity and validity towards the incident. And as one as well as these scholars who have placed it in their book, it is not that they just wake up one morning and had a dream or had some kind of ilham, inspiration, and say we need to put this in our book of Sirah. They use a narration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the narration about the incident is narrated by Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu, which is one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it could be found in the book At-Tirmizi. So Imam At-Tirmizi, he has written this narration in his book. And as we all know, from the six most authentic book of hadith, we have Sahih al-Bukhari, then immediately after that you have Sahih Muslim, and then you have Jami al-Tirmizi. So that is the third most authentic book of hadith that we accept. And to have the hadith recorded in the book of Tirmizi, definitely it has to be an authentic tradition. As well as Ibn Hajar al-Makki, he says that the narration that is found in Tirmizi concerning the incident of Maisara, he says that this is the most authentic narration in or according to the subject. So when we talk about the trip that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had taken, he's saying that the narration in Tirmizi is the most authentic they have that with regards towards the trip, because there's other narrations could be found in other books of hadith. But when we look at the most authentic book that has it will be in At-Tirmizi. Also, Gir bin Jamhu, he says, whoever claims that the hadith that deals with Maisara, that Maisara saw the angels shading the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Khadija radiallahu anha has seen the clouds shading the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, whoever claims that that narration is not authentic, then he says such a claim is utterly false. Because it is in the book of hadith, book of narration. Now if there is a narration of something, you have a clear hadith about something, if someone wants to reject it, then the only way of rejecting that is if there is an ayat of the Quran, that is one. And the second is if there is another narration that says that this is false. But if there is no narration that says it is false, if there is no ayat of the Quran that goes against it, then we cannot say to ourselves, I do not feel it is authentic. Or it looks to me as if it is something impossible, so I'm going to reject it. We cannot reject things based on our own opinion. Especially if it is from a narration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the incident is taken from a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so that is why we accept the narration. And it is mentioned it's because of all of this that Maisara, when he came up and he gave the full details of what took place between him and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is one of the things that got Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha very curious, and she wanted to get married to him. So it definitely had to be those incidents that took place that got her curious, and we'll see as we go on of the entire episode of how she proposed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we'll deal with Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, her lineage was Khadija bin Khuwaylid bin Asad bin Abdul Uzza bin Husa bin Kila bin Murra bin Ka'b bin Luwai bin Walid bin Fihr, which means her name was Khadija. She was the daughter of Khuwaylid. So her father's name was Khuwaylid, and Khuwaylid was the son of Asad. Asad was the son of Abdul Uzza. Abdul Uzza was the son of Husay. Husay was the son of Kila. Kila the son of Murra. Murra the son of Ka'b, Ka'b the son of Luwai, Luwai the son of Ghalib, and Ghalib was the son of Fihr. So this was her lineage. And she also had a very good lineage. As you know, she was extremely wealthy, and she was a widow. The first husband that she got married to, his name was Abu Halla. Abu Halla bin Zurara. This was the name of her first husband. And from him, she got two sons. So she gave birth to two sons. The two sons, they named Hind and Hala. These were the name of the two sons. And these two sons accepted Islam. After the Prophet claimed to be a prophet, they also accepted Islam. So they are counted amongst the Sahaba. After some time, Abu Hala bin Zurara, he passed away. And afterwards, Khadija radiallahu she got remarried for the second time, and this time she got married to Atik bin Ayn al-Maksumi. So she got married to him, and from him she got a daughter, and the name of the daughter was Hind. So two marriages, and the second marriage to Atik bin Ayn al-Maksumi, he also passed away. So she had an experience to witness both of her husband passing away, which made her feel and not interested in getting married again. And that is why many men afterwards, very wealthy and very handsome, used to come and propose to her, and she used to reject every single one of them. Because she was not interested, because of her experience, knowing that she had loved her husband, and each one of them passed away, both of them. So she wasn't thinking on the line of getting married again. She was thinking to herself, this is it, I'm not going to get married anymore. So she had no interest, so much so that she started to focus in only business. She started to spend her life in her caravans and her money that she had, until the trip that Maisara took with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when Maisara came back, he is the slave of Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. So he brought the money and the goods back to her. Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam just dropped it there. He took it. Maisara took it to Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. And when she started to ask of the details of the journey, Maisara explained to her all the different events. So she was amazed because she herself witnessed it when she was in her room on the second story, and she saw the clouds passing, and she called the woman and said, look at the cloud giving shade to the caravan. So she as well had saw that. So she was very amazed by that. That was one. And the second was the amount of profit that she got. Normally anyone that goes for her on that journey, they will normally bring maybe a 50% of the profit. But Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he brought back all the money for her. So when she saw the amount of profit she got, she knew that this man is a very honest man. So he's honest, as well as the thing she's hearing about him from Maisara made her very curious. So she wanted to know more about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So she went to her cousin. She went to her cousin by the name of Waraka bin Nawfal. Waraka bin Nawfal, he was one of the monks from amongst the Christians, and he was very loyal. He was her cousin, and before she got married to her first husband, she was supposed to get married to Waraka bin Nawfal. This was, it's mentioned in the seerah, it was supposed to be, and she ended up getting married to Halla, Abu Halla bin Zarara instead. So anyway, she went to her cousin because she knew that he's very well known, especially in the Christian scripture. And she told him the entire detail of what Maisura told her and about the journey. And he said to her, if what you're saying is truth, about the clouds shading him and those things, if what you're saying is the truth, then definitely he's the last and final prophet. So she was curious and she found out that he's the last and final prophet. And then she became interested more to get married to him. So it was not only about the prophet that she had, which is the amount of money that she received. The other reason is because of him really being a prophet. So she has some clue now that maybe this man, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, might be the last and final prophet. So she wanted to propose to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Many times we read the books of Sirah, and when we read this, for example, when we were small, we were not even for me as well, but as we were not, many times we hear of the journey, and we hear that soon after the journey, she proposed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we think that it is only a few days after that took place and she just went up to him and proposed. But it was not like that. She was curious about him, so she went and started investigating about him. She asked, what have I been up for? And only after two months and 25 days, after Maisura came up, only then she sent the proposal. So she took that time in trying to make sure that she's going to make the right decision. She did not just say, yes, you have brought so much of money, yes, I'm going to get married to you immediately. So she took a very long period, 2 months and 25 days, thinking about it, contemplating to make sure that she's going to make the right decision. Because again, she was not so much interested in getting married after what happened in the first two marriages. So when she was ready to propose, she was not bold enough to just go up to the Prophet and say, I want to marry you. Not like that. So she had a friend by the name of Nafisa. Nafisa was the daughter of Mania. So she went to her friend Nafisa and she said to her, I'm interested in getting married to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Nafisa now, she took the message. After Khadija confided in her, she took the message. And again, when she reached Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she didn't immediately say to him, Khadija wants to get married to you. When she reached to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she asked him, she said to him, why aren't you getting married? How come you're 25 years old and you do not want to marry? Why are you not married? And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that I do not have anything. I do not possess anything. I'm not wealthy. I cannot maintain or provide for a wife. Because especially in those days, the man used to be the provider of the home. Women never used to go out and work and try to assist in the home. The women were only known as housewives. So he knew to himself, I do not have any money. How would I be able to provide for a wife? So he says to her, I am very poor. How can I get married? I have nothing. She says to him, if I could sort out that problem for you, if I could get you married to somebody who is wealthy enough that you do not have to take care of her, that she's wealthy enough and she will take care of herself. You just have to get married to her. He asked her, he says, which kind of woman would do that in our time? Which type of woman living in our society would do something like that to get married to someone without the husband taking care of her? And then she said to him that Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, she is interested to get married to you. And when he heard that, he was amazed because he knew that many men wanted to get married to Khadija, but she always used to refuse. And all of a sudden, she wants to get married to him, and she was the wealthiest amongst all of them. There was no other that was more wealthy than Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. But after he got this news and he was very happy, he did not make a decision even though he wanted to get married to Khadija. And this is also a teaching for us. Many a times the youngsters these days, as soon as they see a girl to get married to, instead of consulting with the parents, they just bring home the girl and say, I'm going to marry to her. So they're just informing you, they're not asking you your permission. They just bring them home and say, Mom, Dad, this will be your new daughter-in-law or your new son-in-law. This is how it operates these days. But Rasulullah, he never used to make decisions decisions like that by himself. So after he got that good proposal, he went to his uncle because he was under the care of his uncle at the time. And he said to him, I got a proposal today that I heard of Khadija and she's interested to get married to me. What do you think about that? And Abu Talib, he knew what type of individual Khadija is. As you mentioned in the past, that her title was At-Tahira. Just as how his title was Al-Amin, the most trustworthy, her title was At-Tahira, the most pure of all of them. So even though she was a widow, she was known amongst the people as being the most purest of women, as well as being the most wealthiest. So we have two characters there being pure as well as wealthy. So Hamza, radiallahu anhu, was another uncle of the Prophet. He and Abu Talib, the both of them, they went to reach the guardian of Khadija, radiallahu anhu. At that time, her father had already passed away. Her father, by the name of Khuwailid, he had passed away before Harb al-Fajr. We talked about Harb al-Fajr last week, which was the battle of the criminals, the sacrilegious wars. Before those battles took place, he had already passed away. So they went to reach her uncle by the name of Amr bin Asad. So they went to talk to him to finalize everything, and they agreed to get married. Both families agreed, yes, we're going to get married. And as you know, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was only 25 years old, and Khadija radiallahu anha, and she was 40 years old, which means there was a 15 years difference. So again, all of these are all of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam are teachings for us. Sometimes we have our son, and our son brings home someone maybe 5 years older than them, and many times the parents will say, no, she too old for you, she will rule you. And this is a mentality many mothers have, especially, that they wouldn't want their son to get married to anyone that is too older than them. Look at Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's only 15 years, and he's going to get married to someone that is 40 years. And who he's getting married to is not someone who has never got married before. He's getting married to someone who was married twice. She already had 3 children, because 2 from the first husband, 1 from the second husband, and yet he's agreeing to get married to her. So Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam got married to her. This was his first wife. He spent 25 years with her. They lived for 25 years until she passed away. And during that period of time, he never married anyone during that space of time. So for 25 years, from 25 years old until 50 years old, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam only had 1 wife, which is Khadija radiallahu anha. Only after Khadija radiallahu anha, she died, only then he got married to others. But for that entire period of time, he stuck with the only 1 wife, which was Khadija radiallahu anha. Abu Talib was at the nikah. He was the one that did the khutbah for the nikah. And when he did the khutbah that he did is mentioned in the books of Sirah. He said, "Amma ba'd, fa inna Muhammadan mimman la yuwazinu bihi fatan min Quraysh illa raja'a bihi sharafan wa nablan wa fadla wa aqla wa in kana fil mal qalla fa innahu dalla za'ilun wa 'ariyatun mustarji'atun wa lahu fi Khadijatu bint Khuwaylid." So this was his khutbah that he recited on that day. He says, "Amma ba'd, fa inna Muhammad, certainly Muhammad, mimman la yuwazinu bihi fatan min Quraysh, there is no youngster amongst the Quraysh that could be weighed against him." He says about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "No youth, no youngster amongst the Quraysh that could be compared to him, that could be weighed against him. Illa raja'a bihi sharafa," except that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would always outweigh them and surpass them in sharaf and in nobility. He will surpass them in eminence, he will surpass them in graciousness, wa aqlan, and he will surpass them in intelligence. That is how great is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, "Wa in kana fil mal qalla," even though he doesn't have plenty of wealth, because he's very poor. The other youths might have a lot of wealth, but they don't have as much nobility as him. They might have no wealth, but they are not intelligent as him. They might have no wealth, but they are not more eminent than him. So he says, then he says, فَإِنَّهُ تَلَّ زَائِلٌ. But wealth is what? Wealth is just a passing shadow. All they have is only wealth. And wealth is, إِنَّهُ تَلَّ زَائِلٌ. Wealth is only a thing you have to return it. So it will not be with you forever. Then he says, Wala wufil Khadija bintu Fuwailin Rabbatun. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he has a desire to get married to Khadija. Wala hafihi mithla dhalik. And she as well has a desire to get married to him. So this was the khutbah that was done by Abu Talib. It's also mentioned it was a second khutbah that was done by Baraka bin Nawfal, because he was present at the nikah ceremony as well. So the two of them did the khutbah, one and two. And the dowry, what we call in Arabic the mahar, that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave to Khadija radiallahu anha, was 20 camels. So he gave her 20 camels as a form of a dowry. And Khadija radiallahu anha, she had a cow killed, and they had their walim and their feast. So they had a big feast there as well. And all the children that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had was from Khadija radiallahu anha, except one, which is Ibrahim. He had a son by the name of Ibrahim. He got with him from Maria al-Qibtiya. Inshallah, we'll reach when he got married to her, we'll deal with her. But as for Ibrahim, all his mother children was from Khadija radiallahu anha. So he had, in total, he had six from Khadija radiallahu anha, and he had one from Maria, which means he had seven children in total. So the set from Khadija radiallahu anha, the first child that they got was Qasim. That's why he was given the title Abu Qasim, because that was his first son, Qasim. So the first child was Qasim, the eldest son, and then afterwards she got Abdullah, which is the second child. And Abdullah was nicknamed Tahir and Tayyib. These were two names given to him, but his real name was Abdullah. There were the two sons, and then they got the first daughter, which was Zainab. And after Zainab, they got Ruqayya, then Umm Kulthum, and then Fatima. So all the children came from Khadija radiallahu anha, which means Khadija radiallahu anha, in total she had nine children. She had nine children, which six for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and two for the first husband and one for the second husband. So nine children in all she got. As for the sons of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these two, they didn't grow too old. They died at a very young age. And the reason for that is because they being the last and final prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't want anyone to grow up to claim succession of prophethood. Because normally when a father leaves a son feels that I need to take over. And Allah didn't want that, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused all the sons to die before they reached a certain age. And as for the daughters, all of them had migrated to Medina. And all of them were Muslims, all of them accepted Islam. And the first three died during the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which was Zainab, Ruqayya, and Umm Kulthum. All three passed away whilst the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was alive. So the only child he had with him when he died was Fatima. All the rest had already died. So when he was on his deathbed, only one daughter remained, which was Fatima. But before he died, he whispered something in her ears. And she started to cry. And then he called her again, and he whispered for the second time in her ears. And she started to smile. And then Aisha radiallahu anha, she was there, she wanted to know what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had said to Fatima that made her cry once and then made her smile. And then after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died, Aisha radiallahu anha, she went to Fatima and asked. And it was mentioned that the first time Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam whispered in her ear, he said to her that I'm going back to my home. He said, I'm going to die. And that is why tears was in her eyes. And then when he called her back, he said to her, you're going to be the first to accompany me. You're going to be the first to accompany me where I'm going. And after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, 6 months after that, Fatima radiallahu anha, she passed away. So she didn't live long after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Khadija radiallahu anha, as you mentioned, that one of the reasons that she got married to him was thinking that he's going to be the last and final prophet. And this was always her desire. She wanted to be the wife of the last and final prophet. So when she heard all these tales and all these stories of Maisara, she had some kind of confidence that definitely this man is going to be the last prophet. And once it is mentioned in the Sirah that once Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came And she saw him and she ran and embraced him. And after embracing him, she says, Bi abi wa ummi, I swear by my mother and my father. He says, Wallahi, ma af'ala hadha li shay'in walakinni arju an takuna anta an-nabiy alladhi satub'ath. She says, I swear by Allah, ma af'ala hadha li shay'in, I did not get married to you for any ulterior motives. I did not get married to you for any ulterior motives, but the only reason I married you is because I hope that you're going to be the one Allah is going to make the last and final messenger. This is why I'm married to you. And she says, فَإِن تَكُنْ فَهُوَ فَعَارِفْ حَقِّ وَمَنْزِلِي. She says, if you are the messenger of Allah, and when Allah does give you prophethood, do not forget my rights, do not forget my position, and do please wadu ilaha alladhi yab'athaka li, and make dua, supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on my behalf. So this is what she's asking him in case he's the prophet. And Rasulullah replied to her and he says, wala in kuntu ana huwa, if I'm really the prophet, because he didn't know he's going to be a prophet as yet neither. So he says, if definitely if I am the prophet, but istana'ta inni ma la ardihi abada, I will never forget the favors you have given to me. All the good things you have done for me, I will never forget this. And he says, wa in yakun ghayri, if it so happens that I am not the prophet, if it so happens that I'm not the prophet, فَإِنَّ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي تَصْنَعِينَ هَذَا لِأَجْلِهِ لَا يُضِيعُكَ أَبَدًا. For verily the God, which is Allah, verily the God who is sending prophets, definitely He's not going to forget the goodness you have done to me. So if I'm the prophet, I'm not going to forget your goodness. And even if I'm not the prophet, I'm sure the God is not going to forget the goodness that you have done to me. So you don't have to worry. And also it is mentioned that she used to frequently go to Waraqa bin Nawfal while living with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Any small thing she sees, she would go to Waraqa bin Nawfal and find out, is it time for him to be the prophet? Is he going to get revelation very soon? It is mentioned that she was going so frequently to Waraqa bin Nawfal that once Waraqa bin Nawfal, he said in one poem, he says, Hadi Khadija, ta'tini li akhbiraha wa ma'lana bi khafi al-ghayb. This Khadija, she's coming to me for me to inform her of something I have no knowledge of, because it is something unseen. I do not know exactly when Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is going to get the message or get the revelation. Khadija radiallahu anha, she's considered to be one of the best women and one of the most praised women in this world. There's mentioned in a narration in Bukhari Muslim that once Jibreel alayhi salam, he came to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and he said to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Khadija radiallahu anha, she will be soon coming with food. This is Jibreel alayhi salam saying that Khadija radiallahu anha, she will be soon coming with food. When she comes with the food, give her salams from Allah. Send salams to her from Allah. Allah is sending salam to her, as well as give her my salam, which is the salam of Jibreel alayhi salam. And give her the glad tidings that Allah has prepared a palace for her in Jannah that is made out of gold. So when she came with the food, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa informed her that Allah just sent salam to you, as well as Jibreel alayhi salam. But hearing that, she says, Allah huwa salam. Allah is already a salam. So there's no need for me to say wa alaykum as-salam to Allah, because Allah's name is salam. But as for Jibreel, wa ala Jibreel as-salamu wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. But as for Jibreel, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also send salam and mercy and blessings to him. And from all the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she was the only one Allah himself sent salam to. No other wife did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself send salam to. So she was special, and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loved her a lot. And even after she died, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to speak about her plenty. He used to mention her, he used to reach her friends and give them gifts and presents out of appreciation for Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. And it is mentioned as to the sequence of who is the greatest of the women in this world. One narration from Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says, Sayyidatun Nisa'il Alameen Maryam. He says, the leader amongst the she didn't see Khadija radiallahu anha. She was very small when Rasulullah got married. And he got married to her when he migrated to Medina. So Rasulullah wasallam, Khadija had already passed away. So she said, I do not even know Khadija, but she is still the greatest threat to me. I envy her the most. Because Rasulullah wasallam used to always speak of her. In front of all his wife, he never stopped speaking about Khadija radiallahu anha. And he used to always say, Allah has given me her love. Allah has given me her love. Allah has placed in my heart that special love that I must love Khadija radiallahu anha. Even though she died, I still love Khadija radiallahu anha. In another incident, Khadija's sister by name of Halla, she came over and she started to speak, and her voice was very similar to Khadija radiallahu anha. So Rasulullah said, when he came in, he heard his voice just like Khadija radiallahu anha. He said, I swear this has to be Halla. It has to be Halla is in the house, because the two of them are sisters and you know that they normally speak just like one another. And he started to speak a lot of good things about Khadija radiallahu anha at that moment, because by hearing her voice, he started to remember his days with Khadija radiallahu anha. And Aisha radiallahu anha, she was right here and she was feeling jealous. This man is still talking about his first wife. And she said to him, she even replied to him, she said, why are you keep talking about that old lady who passed away so many years? Why are you still talking about her? She has gone so long ago. And look, you have so much of young wives here, and you're still talking about that old lady. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, there's no wife that is better than Khadija radiallahu anha. Be it if you are more younger than her, you cannot be better than Khadija radiallahu anha. And he said to Aisha radiallahu anha, Khadija radiallahu anha, she supported me. She was always by my side, even during the boycott that took place in Makkah, she was right here with him. As well as she's the one that is the mother of my children. So definitely I must have that special love for Khadija radiallahu anha. She was also the first to accept Islam, because as soon as he became the Prophet, as well as there's also an incident that took place that Aisha radiallahu anha, she used to boast. She used to boast the other wives and said to them that I am the only wife that Rasulullah got that was aborted. Because all the other wives that he married, they were married before. Every single one of them, the only virgin he married to was Aisha radiallahu anha. So she used to be proud of it. She used to be happy. So she used to always tell the other wives, I am so lucky that I was the only virgin that was given to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Fatima radiallahu anha, she heard that and she was feeling sad that Aisha radiallahu anha, she's serious, and what about my mother, Khadija radiallahu anha? So she went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and she mentioned what Aisha radiallahu anha is saying. And Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to her, whenever you hear her say that again, what you should reply to her is that, say to her, that yes, you are the first virgin that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but my mother, which is Khadija radiallahu anha, she was the only wife that was given Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a virgin. So if she's happy about that, say that to her. So Khadija radiallahu anha, she was the only wife that got the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a virgin as well. So Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he lived with her, as he mentioned, 25 years. He loved her a lot. She died on the 11th of Ramadan, on the 10th year after prophethood. She was 65 years old. Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he himself put her body in the grave. At that time, there were no salatul janazah, so no salatul spread on her as yet. That command did not come down as yet. And her grave is in Hajjun, a place called Hajjun. And up to today, many people, they will go and they will visit the grave of Khadija radiallahu anha. So this is Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam's marriage to Khadija radiallahu anha. So inshallah, during his life at Khadija radiallahu anha, we'll go through, inshallah, in our next session, we'll talk about the rebuilding of the Kaaba. This took place while he was married to Khadija radiallahu anha. This inshallah we end. سبحانه وبحمده سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد ان لا اله الا انت نستغفرك